people here know where your water comes from?
God.
God.
Faucet.
The first of our newest state mandate water conservation measures were presented by our local Golden State Water Company on May 20th. And it started out pleasant enough. An overcapacity crowd of concerned water consumers flooded into this Marriott Courtyard Hotel conference room to hear the first level of the mandated water conservation measures all water districts in the state are forced to impose on residential as well as commercial users beginning June 1st, 2015.
25% across the state has been reconfigured and redetermined to be
Golden State Water District Representative Ken Vecchiarelli tried his best to lay out the new restrictions to the cramped crowd of West County water customers, who weren't just cranky about the cramped quarters. Many were concerned about the new state-imposed water restrictions about to befall them.
Concrete. I don't have a single blade of grass on my property because I tore it all out in the last drought. We take Navy showers. We don't flush after every meal. Tell me, how do I hit my 16% and not have a flow restrictor or be charged more because I've been doing it for 10 years?
You won't. Yes. It sounds like that if you were a water hog in 2013 and you were, and then the other customer was a water conservator in 2013, then the water hog has an advantage.
Yeah. The point is, the water hog still has.
Because much of the information in the new water mandates are only now being rolled out, and the concern of the overflow crowd at this meeting quite apparent, Golden State's Mr. Vecchiarelli promised a second public information meeting, which did take place on June 1st, at the more spacious Cottonwood Christian Center. There, a more systematic and updated presentation of the new drought-driven requirements were laid out again for the public.
It is 6:30, so we are going to get started here. For those folks that are here, I want to welcome you and thank you for coming. My name is Ken Vecchiarelli. I'm the general manager of the Orange County District of Golden State Water Company. Golden State Water Company is...
We present that June 1st public outreach meeting to you now, which includes the most recent local mandates for water conservation currently in effect, with some additional local and statewide resource information, and a slightly less hostile question and answer period that followed.
Golden State Water Company has been in the business of serving communities in California since 1929. We serve over 75 cities. I believe we have 7 districts. Orange County District is one of the larger ones, but we have a couple even larger to the west of us towards LA, our central and southwest districts. Inside the Orange County District, we have 4 systems. And what that means is just a grouping of pipelines, reservoirs, booster pump stations that provide water service to the communities. The Orange County system, I believe, most everybody here is served by the Orange County system if A, you're a Golden State Water Company customer, and B, you get plugged into the Los Alamitos CSA, or customer service area, and you live either in Stanton, Cypress, Los Alamitos, Rossmore Community Services District, a pinch of Garden Grove. Anyone from Garden Grove here? City of Garden Grove? How about City of La Palma? An even smaller section of the City of La Palma we serve, and a fraction of Orange County in that immediate area. Anyone from unincorporated Orange County that's not in the Rossmore Service District here? No, okay. Bits and spatterings of customers throughout that area make up the Orange County system, and all of our piping in the Orange County system is interconnected, so we report to the state of California as one system, the Orange County system. Over on the east side of town, we have the Placentia customer service area. that is made up of three systems. So the confusion there is even worse. We have the Yorba Linda system, we have the Placentia system, and the Cowan Heights system. And according to the state, all three of those systems are on different parameters and different water reduction goals. It's not simple, it's not easy to understand. The notices that we sent out to the community tried to provide the information that we were filing with the California Public Utilities in order to comply with state mandated water reduction objectives. And I say objectives, that's a nicer way of saying mandatory water reductions, because that's exactly where we are today. And we're gonna talk about that. So I'm gonna test my button and see if those guys up there, they're right on target. I wanna thank Cottonwood Church for hosting this meeting, for supplying us a venue for this meeting on such short notice. They got together, their staff, and they're providing us a beautiful, comfortable room with plenty of seating. I think we definitely could have fit the entire group that came to the first meeting. I apologize again for those folks that came to that first one that had to rearrange your schedules and get back out here. But I do want to thank Cottonwood personally and Mike Wilson, raise your hand, Mike, and his team back there, Ishmael and Edwin. Thank you very much. And where is she? Did I say Ishmael? Thank you. In the background is this little beige circular thing. Who can tell me what that might be? A water tank, sure, a reservoir. Your drinking water comes to you from a couple different locations and is typically either pumped into a reservoir or pumped directly into the system, because basically we're in flatland here, right? I mean, not a lot of hills on this side of the system, on this side of the coast. I mean, on this side of the county where we're at. But those reservoirs provide additional storage for firefighting purposes, to supply water during peak hours of the day when actually the water that's being pumped out of the ground or served from other locations may not be able to keep up. Those reservoirs can provide additional water for the system. And in front of that office, right all around that sign, is actually California-friendly planting. So this was one of our first sites where we ripped out turf and ripped out some water-thirsty plants and set up drip irrigation and a very efficient water delivery system to landscaping. If you have questions about that landscaping or you want to see something a little bit more elaborate, we have demonstration gardens for California planting in our San Dimas office. Now that's kind of far away, but if you're interested, let us know, let our customer service reps know, and we'll at least send you pictures if you don't want to go up that ways. But we also have information on our websites that gives you a lot of information you can peel off and decide what's right for you folks if you're looking at or considering changing out some of your landscaping to more California-friendly landscaping. So I think I introduced, if I forgot anybody, I apologize. You can wave your hand if you want to be introduced. We're here to talk about the California drought and specifically what are the impacts to your water service, and what is Golden State Water Company doing to comply with state mandated must do. That's not a may do, it's a must do regulations to reduce our water use. Then we're going to talk more specifically about that notice we sent out. And again, I don't think it was the clearest form of communication. Hopefully, as I get through this presentation, some of your fears or concerns will be allayed. Some of the questions that you might have could be answered. But at the end of the presentation, we'll have an opportunity for Q&A, that's questions and answers, and an opportunity to share experiences. Make them short and sweet. If you have great ideas for how we might all work together to cut our water use, then we'll have an opportunity at the end of this presentation. So this is a picture of California, and the darker the shading, the worse the drought is. Of course, we're in year four of drought conditions. On the average, this part of Southern California gets about 14 and a fraction inches of rain per year. It's semi-arid. Some folks would say desert, but it's Mediterranean semi-arid, 14.1 inches of rain on average. Well, we've been getting far below that average over the last 4 years. And we have been drawing from our reserves. So any of you folks that are lucky enough to have money in the bank, you understand the concept. When the money stops coming in and you have a little bit in the bank, you draw from those reserves. Sooner or later, if you have no money going back into the bank, those reserves get depleted. And that's the condition that we're really concerned about as a state. Some communities have already run out. That's run out of water and have no access other than water that's trucked into their communities. Very serious. Across the board, this is one of the worst cases of drought in California's history because, or in the history of us having a large population base anyway, because it is impacting all portions of California. Usually the northern half might have plenty of precipitation or rain, and the southern half is looking at conditions that require allocations or reductions. In this case, the entire state, with that dismal, the lowest snowpack on record this year, when they go to check our water supplies for the next coming or the upcoming year, they check the Sierra Nevada Mountains because that's our largest reservoir across the state. For those of you folks that saw the little graphic we had in the front as you were coming in, you could see that this portion of Southern California gets some of its water from the northern part of the state, north of the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta. Part of it comes from the Colorado River, 245 miles plus to the east. And then a good part of it comes out of the basin beneath us. And we're blessed and fortunate to have that resource. But again, like a bank, when you draw and draw and draw out of that bank without putting anything back in there or not putting enough in there compared to what you're drawing out, you have a negative reserve or an issue. Oop, did I not press it enough? Okay, I pressed it twice, but hopefully you only went one, right? I just saw, and I can't link to the internet, but you folks can probably find it on YouTube. I just saw today a picture, actually a video of a drone showing today's condition on Lake Oroville. And it was kind of neat, but it flew by areas like this and showed the bathtub ring in one of the state's largest reservoirs, Lake Oroville. Lake Shasta, of course, is part of that Northern California system. But it's not getting any better, and with no snowpack, that's where we're at today. Now, the second bullet point on this shows that Californians have saved nearly 153 billion gallons of water from June 14 to March 2015. Last year at about this time, the governor, actually a little bit earlier in March, the governor declared the drought conditions and asked all of us to cut back 20% on our water usage compared to 2013. And we issued some information to everybody, and I think four primary bullet points that were water waste restrictions. And based on those, sort of a voluntary situation, the 20% goal was not reached. Collectively across the board, California reached 9%. Of that 20% goal. This year, the governor declared that the drought has not gotten any better, and what was voluntary is now mandatory. You didn't take me seriously at 20%, so now it's 25%, and the conditions in our reserves are worse, and this time it's mandated. Some pictures from NASA. Of course, the white is snowpack over the Sierra Nevada Mountains and into Nevada and Colorado. That deep, dark oval spot is basically the basin, California Central Basin. And you can see the big difference between 2013, which was still a low water year for us, below average water year, and what it looks like in 2014 and 2015. So again, dismal water resource conditions. So this is pretty much the graphic that I had up front, basically showing you that to get water to your taps, it makes quite a big journey. And to get water back even into the basin beneath us, the primary source is typically the Santa Ana River watershed, which is a local watershed, but still a very large watershed. Well, when no snow lands on those mountains and very little rain lands on that basin in general, there's not a lot of water making its way down the Santa Ana River for us to use to recharge this Orange County basin. The small graphic on the left there with the blue is typically where underground water basins are. But you folks have been reading the newspapers and tracking this information, and you know that a lot of those basins are being depleted to the point where there's actually land subsidence. Water is a very precious commodity, especially in the state of California. That little yellow area in that bigger map represents the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California's service area. That's where about 18 million people reside in the state of California. And those import water sources, water from the California Aqueduct and the Colorado River, which are purchased for us and managed for us by both the state and Metropolitan Water District, they have to make it through that network of both natural rivers and man-made canals and channels to get down here to that territory of the yellow shading. And we're just a small fraction of that in Orange County. Well, a large fraction, but here in Orange County. It's just sort of a graphic again that shows the various stages of water in the various reservoirs across the state of California system and metropolitan system. And on the right hand, my left, your right, that red line beneath the bell curve, I guess you would say, the bell curve is the average Sierra Nevada snowpack on the top, and the red line is where it is today. And over when it started going up in December of 2014, they thought, hey, we're almost at an average year. We're gonna allocate 20% of your resources, 20%. 100% means we get all the water that we would order normally from the State Water Project. And in December they said, oh, it looks like we're on track for maybe hitting average. We'll go ahead and up the ante from 5% to 20%. Well, look where that red line went. Never got anywhere near that bell curve. So this year we get 20% of our state allocation of State Water Project water. Down below, a little better conditions on the Colorado River. But as you could tell from the previous slide, the Colorado River Aqueduct, we're only allowed a certain amount of water on that, and actually that aqueduct can only transport a certain amount of water. Typically, we get about one-third of the import water from the Colorado River. Well, this year, fortunately, we're maxing out that canal through the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California and taking a large supply of our import water from the Colorado River. So there's a drill-down version of Orange County, and the blue, again, is a underground basin, the Orange County Water Basin, and that is managed by the Orange County Water District. We are a member agency of that district, along with other cities and local water districts. We purchase our water pumped out of the ground. It's pumped through piping that has meters. We purchased it from the Orange County Water District each and every year. And they decide what a healthy level is for the basin and how much water we can take out of the basin each year, spread all across cities and districts within the Orange County Water District boundary. What's not shown below is basically the southern part of Orange County. They don't have access to the groundwater basins, so they're very heavily dependent on that import water source. Here, we get about 70% of our water out of that basin, and the other 30% is imported. Down in South County, 90% or more of their water is imported. So even within this county alone, there's a big difference in water supply availability. Sort of a graphic just showing you, okay, to the left is a basin that's full. You can see those pipes going down into the underground aquifer, that reservoir beneath us. And you can see there's plenty of water to supply to the underground standpipe, essentially, that we put a well in and a pump and pump that water out to the ground level and up into reservoirs and up into the community. To the right is a picture of where that basin goes after several years of taking out more water than we're able to put in. In years of surplus water, we're able to take water from those import sources before it's treated and transport some of that into basins that are managed again and used as percolation ponds to recharge the underground aquifer. We also collectively have all invested in a groundwater replenishment system locally. That's actually treating today 100 million gallons of sewage water to a highly distilled water quality, I mean, nearly distilled water quality. 100 million gallons of Orange County sewage is retreated by both the Orange County Sanitation District and the Orange County Water District, and then pumped back up into pipelines that feed it up to settling basins again to recharge that basin. It also is used as a water barrier to hold back the ocean water, because as you can see in that picture, the ocean is actually higher than the basin. So unless that water in the basin is high enough, that the saline seawater will actually intrude into our drinking water. And again, part of that 100 million gallons of water a day that we recycle collectively is used as a barrier to keep that ocean water out. And it's especially critical as we draw that basin down further. So here we are today, April 1st of 2015, the governor mandated that we are in a state of severe drought, that the water resources that the state has collectively must be conserved. If we have another bad year, low precipitation and dismal snowpack, and no local precipitation on the Santa Ana River watershed, we're in trouble. We've got about a year or so of supplies left. If we don't make changes and we have another bad year, we're going to be back scratching our heads saying we have to do more, and where do we prioritize this precious resource, water use? So across the board, the governor said, okay, California, you did 9%, I want 25. And the state looked at each and every water system. Remember, we had five systems collectively in Golden State Water Company's Orange County system. You're all in one system, the Orange County system. And he looked at gallons per capita per day and water usage across the board in terms of residential water use, basically, in each of the districts, and said, what did you do between April of 2014 and March of 2015? Gave us a scorecard and said, based on your gallons per capita per day, which is gallons of water used per person per day, and where you stand collectively, each system compared to the state average, they gave us a objective and a target. And that target to average across the state for 25% reduction is where we're at. So let's see, we already talked about this stuff. These regulations were approved. Basically, the governor said, make it happen, and the State Water Resources Control Board and the California Public Utilities Commission, two arms of the state government, were told, make it happen. So talk to all the water retailers, make up these regulations, turn it into law, and get it done. The PUC adopted regulations that essentially said, we're going to comply, we're going to make sure that all regulated utilities do their part on May 11th. They also gave us guidelines for those notices that we sent out, what type of information needs to be included in them. Well, the governor also said, and again, you've probably heard this and seen it in the newspapers, that anyone caught wasting water can be fined up to $500 per day. And the water waste prohibitions were communicated through newspapers, through flyers, through bill inserts, and those types of things. Different communities, different cities, and water companies and water agencies have adopted different levels of enforcement for this. The California Public Utilities Commission and investor-owned utilities do not have the enforcement arm to fine you $500 a day. But we can work with local law enforcement agencies and cities and implement this kind of a structure if they're willing to be the enforcement arm. Not too many are. Where we are at is educate, 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 plead, request, and then later fine if you have to. If people are so stubborn, they're not going to do their part, or they don't believe they should, and everyone else is, or most people are, then there's actually code and law that says you could be fined $500 a day. The existing law also says a company like us, or a department of water of the city, or a local water district can be fined $10,000 a day for not complying with water waste prohibitions and for not putting in place systems that ensure that people have gotten the message and that they're complying to do their part to reduce water use in California. The governor has stated that he wants that $500 to go to $10,000 per day. I don't want to be the one to give anybody a $10,000 ticket for wasting water. I don't even want to test that. I don't think most folks do. It's not law yet. $500 a day is law. And I imagine if the governor makes $10,000, the price point, shall we say, for wasting water for residents and community businesses and individual users, I think he's going to raise that ante from $10,000 to $100,000 a day or somewhere like that for agencies and companies that don't comply. We don't want to test that either. So these were the restrictions that were already in place effective June 1st of 2014. You can't water hardscape. Washing off your driveways and sidewalks and buildings and those types of things with drinking water is a prohibition unless there's a serious public need, public health need. Irrigating to the point where there's runoff, and I think most people, most everybody, has run their sprinkler systems at one point in time. We don't control the wind. There's water that gets on the hardscape. Really, the water waste is what we're talking about. And those, either the timer gets stuck or something happens, somebody falls asleep at the wheel, they're just not there and their system hasn't reset and it runs for much longer than it should and most of the water is going across the sidewalk into the curb and gutter. That's water waste. It's drinking water we're putting on our lawns and our landscaping. Washing a vehicle without a hose, I think there's still people that do that. You believe it or not, without a positive shutoff on that hose. So you get your thumb in front of the spray and you wet off the, you spray down the car or the vehicle and you put that thing down, whether it's on grass or you definitely don't want it on your sidewalk or your driveway because it'll show up even quicker. But you put it on your grass and you forget about it and the phone rings and you go and you take a call and then you're in there and the kids say, I'm hungry, dad or mom, and you've got water waste again. So don't wash your vehicle without a positive shutoff hose. And at this stage, really, we recommend that you take your vehicles to a commercial washing company because they recycle a vehicle wash. They recycle a lot of that water. They also treat the wastewater. So now we're down to where this system, which is Golden State Water Company's Orange County system in the Los Alamitos customer service area. What's our target? Our target reduction is 16%. And that's basically because the GPCD, that report card, the gallons per capita per day that we've been reporting every single month to the state, has has basically shown that we're about average for the state of California and GPCD. And so we've about reached that 9% mark. We have 16% to go. I have systems, I have a meeting this Thursday to tell a community that they're in that lucky upper percentile where they have 36% cutback mandated. We're here at 16. I think 16 is doable. I know a lot of you have probably already done your part. You've already adopted good water use habits. I was talking to a couple folks that have already basically converted their landscaping to very efficient drip irrigation systems. They have very little turf. They're taking Navy showers or collecting the water from the faucet in the or from the showerhead in the morning in a bucket when it's warming up and using it to flush the toilet or water plants. I mean, you really can't do much better than that. But everyone is encouraged still to hit those targets. We'll talk more about there's also going to be a floor where we're saying, look, if you're already at a certain point, you won't be subject to any additional tariffs. So here we are in the West Orange County system with a target of 16% effective June 1. Now, that's the law. The California Public Utilities portion hasn't been adopted yet. That notice that we sent in the 6 pages of a advice letter that we sent to the California Public Utilities Commission has not been approved yet. But again, the state has already governed and has already said June 1 is the mandatory 25% starting point. And I'll talk a little bit more about what that means. And primarily across the board, the adjustments that are being asked, besides, you know, making sure that folks aren't wasting water, indoors or outdoors, the target is really cutting back on outdoor irrigation. So there's the chart that shows the Orange County system customers, basically, and where we are in March and where we've been each month. The statewide average is the brown line, so we actually even were below that brown line for part of the year, June and July of last year, even August, September. But then we caught up in October, November, December, went a little bit above in January. Of course, I think January was one of the driest years on, or months on record too this year. But we're basically, again, pretty much at par with the state average. Oh, I'm sorry, let me go back a second. So this officially, some folks have asked in the Q&A part, so what do you use for population? You know, in 2013, I only had 2 people, but my kids have come back from college, and actually we have another relative living with us, and by the way, they've got another child, so we're at 6 people where we were at 2 in 2013. How can I possibly achieve the same water use that I did in 2013 when I have 6 people? The population data in those calculations that we're sending to the state of California, they've given us the guidelines on what to use. It's the 2010 census data. We don't have any more up-to-date information. And the target is based on, if I didn't say it already, the target's not based on your water use last year. It's the water use on 2013. So they're using the same baseline of 2013 and saying effectively across the board, we're asking you to reduce your water usage compared to the same time last year. The same time in 2013. So about 112,000 is the population base that we're reporting for our Orange County system. I think I already basically said, we filed paperwork, and that notice that you got with a lot of words on it basically has all of the meat and potatoes of that paperwork that we filed with the CPUC. They have not approved our Schedule 14.1 yet. They have not approved it. They may not approve it till the middle of June. They may not approve it at all. But the state has no tolerance. They are going to look at that report card in June. We report the numbers in July, whether the CPUC has adopted our tool to try to enforce it or not. We have to report, and if you folks, again, have seen the newspapers, they're going to single out any system and any water retailer that hasn't met the target. That's in the newspapers. Besides that, they have enforcement capability in saying, why haven't you put some conditions in place, some incentives in place, and yes, even some penalties or whatever it takes to get people's attention to cut back on water usage. I'm suggesting as a community that today is our starting point if you haven't already. So we used, so we have mandatory water conservation and rationing in place. I think that was the title of that filing. Mandatory water conservation and rationing, schedule 14.1. It does list on the back sheet, I think, of your notice, prohibited water use A through M. Eight of those, I think, we read in the bullet points, but there's several others. So this is the education part. Now, on top of that, we're sending information out on bills. We're trying to, for those of you that don't have access to your 2013 water usage or can't dig it out from the file cabinet, we're actually putting a request online that you can go online and ask for your 2013 usage. Now, we'll also provide it as a mail out, but because we bill every other month, we bill you folks typically for on the average a 60-day water use period. That's going to be too late, especially folks that just got their bills. You're not going to get another bill for 2 months. You're not going to know what your 2013 usage is or where your target for reducing water use will be. We're going to try to make sure you have that information in your hands over the next few weeks. So what's going to happen if you don't cut back your water use? Well, we're going to plead. We're going to write a written warning. If you still are unable to reduce your water use for whatever reason, and we believe that it's strictly by choice and not by necessity, then we do have the authority to install what's called a flow restrictor. And if any of you folks have seen those aerators that we give out for your kitchen faucets, those take water that's coming out of a hole about that big. Well, this is an exaggeration, but picture this is your faucet, and then there's a little plastic plate in there that reduces the hole size down considerably. Well, that's the kind of device that we will install before your meter if we get to the flow restrictor section. That will allow enough water to maintain public health and safety, but you're really not going to be able to water your lawns. You're not going to be able to take a real comfortable bath or shower. Again, we don't want to get there, and that step is really in response to someone's choice. On that paperwork, we indicated how much we will charge you to have a crew go out and install that device called a flow restrictor. And in that fee is also the cost to have our team remove that restrictor, because sooner or later we figure you're going to want it removed if it was installed, so you can really get the benefit of the full flow of water use. Those fees are based on the meter size, and that's based on, again, the cost of doing that. If that still doesn't get folks' attention and they find ways to waste water, we can shut off your service. If we shut off your service, we have to talk to code enforcement and in some cases the fire authority and let them know that there's no water to that house. That could result in a red tag situation that says you're not able to occupy your home. Again, not something we want to do. So, where are we going to start all this? On that notice that we gave you, there were four stages identified. We're going to start on stage one. What is stage one? Cutting back on your outdoor water use. We are going to have all of the, first of all of the water waste prohibitions and the water use reductions apply to all water customers. of Golden State Water Company. So retail, commercial, public institution, and residential. So we're not just picking on residential customers, we're applying the mandates across the board. Stage one is for outdoor water use. We're gonna restrict irrigation to 2 days a week. So mandatory, the first mandatory point is limiting the outdoor water use to 2 days a week. And we have assigned water use based on addresses. So even numbered addresses will have Sunday, Wednesday as their watering days, and odd numbered addresses will have Saturday and Tuesdays. Well, you know, again, a lot of people, I've got my timer set, I've got them dialed in. Why do I have to make changes? We are required to put in place a system that we can enforce, or that can be enforced by whatever means. And this is one of the easiest ways to do it. We are not adding people. We are not trying to increase the cost of providing service. We are not hiring the water police. So this is kind of an easy way for folks to see if somebody didn't get the message, or somebody didn't get a chance to change their timers. One whole side of the street was watered in a particular day and someone else is still watering on the other side of the street. They've got their automated systems going. We may find out about that, provide notice that we found out, inform the customer that there are these restrictions in place. If you haven't heard, here are the restrictions, here's our website, here's more information. Your days for watering are one of these two.
You got your days wrong. You crossed them up, sir.
I'm sorry?
You said just the opposite of what it says.
I think I said the bullet points in the opposite order, but that's what's happening. Even numbers Wednesday and Sunday, odd numbers Tuesday, Saturday. I confuse you again? I'll read them in order. Odd numbers Tuesday and Saturday, even numbers Wednesday, Sunday. Was that consistent three times? We have the tapes. I don't know. Anyway, it's on your notices as well if I mess that up. And it will be on your bills as well. So in stage one, there's no allocation. Well, what's an allocation? Well, what year is your baseline? 2013. That's your baseline. And what's the target reduction? 16%. So your allocation or water allotment target is your baseline minus 16%. Not yet adopted by the PUC, but again, the state is looking at the report card, and our goal and objective is not to get past stage two. So if I can't convince you all to reduce your water usage with stage one, we have to go to stage two. And stage two includes everything in stage one, but some financial incentives. $2.50 per CCF of water above your allocation. So just as an example, if you used 20 units of water as a family or a business or wherever you folks are using that water in our community, if you used 20 on average in the month, and I'm just gonna do quick math, what's 10% of 20? Two. What's 15% of 20? Three. Okay, so you know if you use 20, then you know that you need to use a little less than 17, right? So you're just be safe. You have a target of 16. That's basically how it's going to work. So if you used in June of 2013, you had an average bill of 20 CCF per month. You need to have a water usage reduction that shows that you're at about 16 and a fraction units of water per month. If you don't, and we are in stage two, you will be charged for that extra water above the allocation, $2.50 per CCF. So those other three units you did not conserve, you will pay an extra $7.50 on your bill. Does everyone understand that? If we still aren't making the mark, and the state of California says we're into August or September, the three hot months in a row, And by golly, that West Orange County system of Golden State Water Company has upped their water usage from 2013. Not only did they not cut back 16%, but they increased 5% overall from their 2013 usage. We're either gonna fine Golden State Water Company, which means if we get fined, those costs typically are passed on to our customers, or they're going to require that the state puts on more restrictions, adopts more laws or rules to say it's not voluntary anymore. We have to, as a community, meet the mark. If we have to go from stage two to stage three, every CCF, which, by the way, a CCF is our billing unit to you. It's 100 cubic feet. 100 cubic feet. That's 748 gallons. So every billing unit is almost 750 gallons. It actually sounds kind of cheap, $2.50, but that's above what you're already paying for your water. Okay? Which I know not everybody in here, most everybody in here, is not real pleased with what you pay in the first place, but that's above and beyond what you're paying on the bill already. If we have to go to stage three, that ante is going to double to $5 per CCF. If that still doesn't work, we're going to up the ante in stage four to $10 per CCF. To go from stage one to stage two, we have to file again with the PUC and provide notice to the community that we are going from stage one to stage two. So you'll get plenty of warning, but I'm here to say I don't want to get there, and I don't want our customer service folks to be inundated with appeals and with trying to figure out allocations for those folks that have a story or a reason why they can't cut their water by 16%. There's no appeals process in stage one. There's no appeals. The notice probably said that the appeals will be handled online. It might have even said you can submit an appeal online. We're not accepting appeals unless we go into stage two. Stage one, cut back 2 days a week watering. If we're in stage two or three or four, we will not be applying these surcharges that I mentioned, the $2.50, the $5, and the $10. We won't apply that for usage below 8 CCF. So if you use 8 CCF a month or less, you won't be in this situation. You still will be asked in the information on your bill to reduce by 16%. If you don't, you haven't helped collectively, but you're really not a huge target. And you're not going to be, if the PUC adopts what we're recommending and allows us to implement this Schedule 14.1, you won't be charged for any usage 8 CCF or less per month. To give you an idea where that's at, that's basically 50 gallons of water each person for a four-person home for 30 days. That's pretty much indoor water use on average, including washing dishes and washing clothes and everything else. That's pretty much an indoor baseline. But that baseline will not be penalized if we are in stage two, three, or four. If you're already below, at eight or below, don't call for an appeal. You don't need one. If we're in stage two, three, and four, is that kind of clear? I guess I'll find out from the questions. But you don't need an appeal if you're already below that point. So how do I make it there? How do I cut? Where do I cut? What do I do? We really think for this area, 16% is very, very doable. Across the board, basically, if you cut your outdoor water use to 2 days a week, and you can restrict the water that's going through those sprinklers to less than 15 minutes or less per cycle, one cycle, or really, the best way to do that is split up into multiple cycles, maybe 5 minutes apiece. But you really don't need, most plants don't need 15 minutes of watering. They just flat don't. And 2 days a week is going to be more than enough to keep things live. It really is. Unless you've been overwatering and you've got real shallow roots, which means your plants aren't real healthy to begin with, and they aren't going to survive the drought real well. If we get another year of below precipitation, these targets are going to go up and your plants or other things are going to be, you are really going to be trying to weigh decisions on what's most important for the water use. We think 16% is very doable just by limiting outdoor water use. However, there are programs in place, and hopefully you folks have seen some of the literature at the front table. Dell and his group are going to keep it out there. If you picked up one of these cards, if you haven't already received an indoor water conservation kit, they're free to our customers, but you have to sign up for it either with this card or online. Also available out there is a, and I think I'm going to have to put my glasses on for this, but there are programs still in place to get rebates for high efficiency water clothes washers, high efficiency toilets, smart sprinkler timers, and those programs are done through third party vendors. One of these flyers out there, or little handouts, has the website ocwatersmart.com, OC for Orange County, watersmart, no spaces.com. That's if you're interested in any of these high efficiency appliances. You're in the market for a replacement washer. That beautiful GE or Maytag that you've had for 45 years has finally kicked the bucket. You know you're gonna replace it, or that's one of the water hogs if it's, you know, not a real recent machine. Say real recent over the last 5 to 10 years, there's probably more efficient ones out there. Are they built any better? I can't testify to that. But there are ratings about their water use. In general, you don't have to buy another utility or appliance. Just make sure that you're using your appliances efficiently. Use full loads for both your washer, your dishwasher, and your clothes washers. If not, take the time to adjust to a small load. Most of our programs that we participate in, and some of your rates do go to fund these programs, and others are paid by your tax dollars, those systems are primarily, or those rebate opportunities are primarily through third-party vendors. But they are reputable vendors. They are community-wide, area-wide vendors in some cases. A lot of information on these handouts and on our website. And I'll show you the link on the website. Oh, it's right there. Go www.gswater.com/conservation. There's some excellent links, a lot of information, but for rebates and programs and helpful hints and ideas on what you can do to save water, go to these sites. Did I not cover enough? Okay. So I just talked about that. There's other things in place, including a turf removal program. Some of you have heard about it, cash for grass, or $2 a square foot is pretty much across the board where the programs have been. Some agencies have been adding to that. Some water retails have been giving $3, maybe even up to $4 a square foot to remove your grass. Most of these are very structured programs. The Metropolitan Water District of Southern California, that import water purveyor that brings the water from those two, the Colorado River Water Aqueduct and the California Water System, they primarily manage the funding of those programs also through third-party vendors. They just approved last week an additional $300 million towards the turf removal program. They had originally adopted a budget with $20 million each year for 2 years. They upped the ante during the governor's first drought declaration last year to $150 million for that turf removal program. They now have added $300 million to that, and they don't believe that'll get them through to the end of the year. So if you're thinking about removing your turf and you're thinking about trying to get a rebate on that, you really need to get those applications in quickly, because they believe that at the rate those applications are coming in, they're still going to run out of funds even with that added $300 million. And there are conditions that you have to comply with to meet those rebate requirements. There's efficient sprinkler head giveaways, and again, a lot of information out there, and most of these can be accessed through that link on our website. We have been doing our best to keep updates of information on our website, trying to make improvements so that you can get to some of these links easier and quicker. A lot of information, like I said, the starting point, www.gswater.com. Towards the top of our website, it says select your community. You should be able to type Stanton or even begin to type STA and Stanton should pop up. Click on that, it'll get you to a web page that's more specific for this area, but in the end, most of these programs that they're linking to can all be accessed on our website. All right, we're nearing the final point here, and Edwin, do you have the comment cards, or does someone else?
I can pick those up.
Okay, great. Yeah, if you can have someone bring those comment cards up. We have a 24-hour, 7 days a week, 365 days a year customer service line. Those customer service reps can handle your calls. Our CSA locally during business hours can handle your calls, and the website, again, we've been putting a lot of attention into getting information on our website that helps you folks figure out how you can meet that 16% reduction, and even more in some cases.
All right, this is it for comment cards so far?
Oh, we got a few more? Okay. I'm going to go through a couple of these, and then again, I will take some other Q&A as well. Right top and center is Alan Smith from the California Pool and Spa Association. Alan provided me a copy of a PowerPoint presentation that his industry has put together that talks about, thank you, Dale. Can you stick around up here to give the mic to some folks? Thanks. And he's here if we get any questions about, what's going on with swimming pools or he's also from the industry, so they are doing some research to try to get information to the state and everybody else. It's basically the regulators have said outdoor irrigation, green lawns and pools down there in Southern California are taking all the state's water. Well, that's not true, but it's still a target. And he's here to answer any questions and maybe give us some information about what is and isn't true according to their industry. Just looking at this very briefly, I know that the pool industry certainly does provide jobs, and when you factor in the water component of that, their point is that that's very good use of the water resource because it provides a lot of jobs throughout the community. There was no really question about that one, though. Okay. What are watering day set? Can we water on a 2 day a week? I think I answered that question. 2 days a week, you will be required to cut back to 2 days a week. And actually, again, I'm appealing that you do it now. June 1st, the state mandates are in place. PUC still hasn't adopted our rule that we're trying to put in place, or our schedule. But I believe they will, and I believe that cutting back to 2 days a week will help us achieve our goals. How do we handle 2013 credit balance with respect to 2015 allocation? Who is responsible for parkways if watered to get rid of... to get rid of grass and replace with gravel. Parkways, that's a great question. One of the state reductions is turf on medians. The state has said no use of drinking water to water turf and medians. Now, some cities are having real issues with that. They, again, have invested your dollars in that landscaping, but the state has said no use of drinking water on medians for grass. Now they can still irrigate the trees, they can still irrigate the shrubs in it and other plants, but no turf can be watered on the medians effective June 1, according to the law. And cities are supposed to have done their part to cut back and actually reduce to zero the use of water in medians. I'm not tracking all city ordinances. I don't know whether or not they're doing that, but we have certainly communicated with our cities that we serve and asked what they're doing and whether or not they intend to comply and how long they think it might take. Really, in our book, Golden State Water Company and the cities and the public institutions, schools, those folks, we need to set an example that we're doing our part as well. So we're reaching out to HOAs, to the schools, to the cities to say, if you're not complying with the law, we should be posting why you're not. So if they're watering parks because they're trying to save the parks, but they haven't allowed certain areas to go dormant or somehow reduce part of their water usage, they should notify us somehow and okay, we've actually reduced our water here, here, and here so that we can keep this park green for you. That kind of thing, I think, is going to help communicate across the board that we're all doing our part. The question was actually about credit balance with respect to 2015 allocation. Oh, and who is responsible for parkways? I don't know if in your particular city you are responsible for irrigating your parkway. And if you cut the irrigation of that parkway, what does the city do to you? Great question. You need to find out with the city first and foremost. If you don't know, when your sprinklers go on, do the sprinkler heads in the parkway pop up? If they do, you're probably paying to irrigate the parkway. If that's all grass, certainly you can do what's needed to be done to do the same to that grass as you're doing to your own grass, and that would be to cut back and allow some to be dormant. If it's trees and shrubs and other plants and you're watering them, we really need to communicate collectively to the cities and agencies that are all responsible for doing our part. That's a tricky one. What I'm suggesting for some city agencies is maybe you can install blank sprinkler heads in some of the sprinklers that are just doing the grass, but still get water to the trees. Of course, the most efficient way to do that is through more efficient drip systems or soaker systems. Not soakers, those aren't real efficient unless they meet efficiency standards. One gentleman had a comment about this. Say,
yeah, you're reading my question, thank you very much.
Oh, sorry. Do want to make sure everybody sees and hears the input.
The first part of my question had to do with, this may be an individual situation. In 2013, I had a credit.
Oh, a bill credit.
I had a bill credit. Okay.
Because so you paid more than your water bill for other months or something like that.
That's correct, yes. So I think the answer to my question, now that I've heard your presentation, is that you have to look at the CCFs. I mean, if that wasn't addressed, then you shouldn't have a problem.
Excellent point. So his question is, he actually got money back or was issued a credit that was applied to later bills, but he still had water usage in the month. So he's absolutely correct. You would look at that water use, whether you paid for it or not, and that's what you're asked to reduce. Thank you very much for clarifying that. Perfect question. The bit about the parkways, you really need to talk to the city, local city or community district, Rossmore, whoever it is, and find out, have they adopted ordinances or resolutions? What are they doing? Because chances are, you're not the only one with that question. There's an awful lot of people. If I'm maintaining the parkway and I've got to have my own grass go dormant, I sure am going to do my bit to, I shouldn't say this in public today. Talk to your local communities or district. Okay, this particular question is a very large family. The count is 6 and 6. It sounds like in a single family residence. Coming from out of state in San Diego in July and August. So they're going to have friends, family, and whoever else in July and August. What impact on the water usage and the water bill? Just guessing, your water bill's going to go up, your water usage is going to go up. Just guessing. Somebody's got a total of 12 visitors coming in July and August. So again, your water usage is probably going to go up, and so will your water bill. Household is currently 2. Well, again, technically, unless we're in stage 2 or above, you're just going to pay for the water you use. You're not going to be fined additionally, the additional $255 or $10, depending. if we're in, chances are very good, if the PUC adopts this in July, we're going to be in stage one. We really, again, are asking everyone to do their bit because the state is going to look at the report card and decide we're not doing enough and make the enforcement tougher, kind of a thing. If we are in stage two, this is the kind of information that you need to get to our customer service reps through the appeals process. And that appeals process will be initiated online. If we're in stage two or above, you'll need to communicate that. Now, in order to give folks an additional allotment, essentially, we're gonna need to do some confirmation, which again, is gonna be very difficult. What are we gonna ask for to actually have you line up these 12 visitors and name them off and give social security name? I don't even know how we're gonna do this, to tell you the truth, but this would be appeals process. Clarification.
That was my question.
Then you're allowed to take the mic.
Thank you. We are a household of two. Our kids are grown, gone, live in Colorado, San Diego. They're all coming for a reunion.
Have them bring water.
Yeah, well, Colorado is not a problem, and San Diego is doing something about it because they're, at least they're expanding reservoirs down there. We're not doing anything. But anyway, bottom line is, how do I handle 12 more people in a household that's normally two? And in 2013, we were gone for a good part of the summer. So I'm basically, you're telling me I'm screwed.
I'm telling you, have them bring water. Now, if we're in stage two or above, we will have the appeals process in place. And sort of roughly speaking, again, if I can sort of forecast into the future, whatever requirement we're going to ask for you to confirm that the household of two went to 14 for 2 months, we'll probably say that just that 2 CCF per person is appropriate. You don't need to water outdoors anymore because of those visitors. You don't need, you know where I'm going with that. So you may get that extra 2 CCF per person per day per month.
The additional, if you can imagine, 6 grandkids, 11 and down to 5, the amount of laundry that's going to be going through that household. So again, that's where the water.
Go to the laundry mat with quarters. That's a different meter.
I'll do it as I run. That's a different meter. The car wash.
Sorry, I'm just making suggestions, and I'm not trying to be.
And I'm not trying to go overboard. I'm just trying to figure out what is going to happen to me.
Car washes. Instead of locally, bring them to the car wash if you can. Navy showers, if it's hot enough in the summer, I can deal with a Navy shower if it's hot enough. If you don't get up in a cold morning, take a shower in the cold morning and have to have it hot, honestly, again, it's whatever we can do. And seriously, you may want to consider a laundromat for some of that laundry because that's a different meter. We're going to have to figure out commercially, they're supposed to cut back by 16%. Everyone's going to be bringing their laundry to the laundromat. How are we going to deal with that? I don't want to go to stage 2, 3, or 4 because I can't figure it out. Sir?
What is your average water pressure to a house supposed to be?
What does that have to do with water usage? If the water pressure is higher, you're going to use more water?
That's absolutely right. Okay. My understanding is it's supposed to be between 65 and 80.
If you're concerned about that, do you have a house valve?
I actually installed one because I know in Rossmore it goes from 90 to 100 PSI.
And that's nothing. 120 PSI is a typical range for 80, actually anywhere from 40 to 120 can be a typical range in a pressure zone. Now, if you're concerned about that, there's two devices, a pressure regulator to your home and a simple ball valve shutoff. You want to reduce your own pressure during flow situations, install a shutoff and partially close it. But a regulator is the best device for that.
I have one, but a lot of people don't know that in our community, and so they can be cutting back just by a notice could go out to recommend to have your pressure checked.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch the last part of that.
A notice could go out to different communities to have your water pressure checked and suggest putting a pressure regulator on that because that can have an awful lot to do with how much volume of water goes in that sprinkler zone.
Any idea how much it is to install a pressure regulator by a plumber? I mean, if you're a do-it-yourselfer, and you trust your plumbing, it's not a terrible deal, but I don't know if any folks are here plumbers by trade. Maybe they can quote you a price, but there are other measures too. If you are above 80 PSI and your home is relatively new, you should already have a pressure regulator. Having your pressure checked, as this gentleman indicated, may be one thing that can help you. Those flow restrictors at the faucets will help. The shower head will restrict the flow and the pressure. All right, I'm gonna jump to another question. I'm sorry, I'm not trying to ignore folks with their hands up. I'm gonna try to go through these. There's only a few more, just in case they're your question or it's something that you might be asking as well. Can desalinization be a viable option for Orange County or the whole of California? Well, gee, with that big water reservoir right next to us, I don't know where it is. Who can point to where the ocean is? There we go, okay. Why aren't we investing in desal? Well, that 100 million gallons a day that you've already invested in sewer water recycling, it's way, way cheaper to actually treat that water than it is ocean desal water, because ocean water is much more saline. It's got a much higher concentration of salt in it. And removing the salts from the water is a power intensive and costly endeavor. That doesn't mean it can't be done. That doesn't mean it shouldn't be considered. But in general, Golden State Water Company is a proponent of making sure that we maximize the water usage and the cost of those water supply systems as much as possible. We're currently looking as a county at that, as the northern part of the county, your rates, and the Orange County Water District that I talked about, currently looking at a desal project in Huntington Beach. Poseidon is the private company that obtained all but one or two permits so far with 12 plus years of time and investment in getting support for that project. Still a very expensive project, still very costly water. If you're in a drought situation continuously, probably doesn't matter what the cost is. If it's off and on, like one out of every 4 years or two out of every 7 years, what do you do in those other 5 years when you can get cheaper water? If you invest in a desal plant, you take that water all the time, or you shutter that investment like some communities have. Investing in a desal system and shuttering a plant, that's a very expensive endeavor if it costs more to operate and maintain and pay for the power to treat that water. Not saying desal is not an option we shouldn't be looking at collectively, but we gotta be very careful and make sure that all of our resource options are available, or that we at least look at them and know what we're paying for. Some folks have said it's worth the extra cost to pay for local reliability. That's a choice you and your regulators, or state regulators and local legislators, will probably be looking at soon. Question, I was out of my home from July of 13 through February of 14. How will my adjustment rate be figured? Probably based on averages in your neighborhood. If it's a residential customer, probably typical lot size, home size in your area. I'm not positive that that's how we're determining the allocations, but I have heard that that's what we're considering. That's probably what it's gonna be for a baseline. If we're in stage two, three, or four, and that's not enough, the appeals process will be in place. Question, I have a swimming pool. Do you help people to cover pools during the drought? We do not help people cover the pools. We do strongly suggest you consider getting a cover for your pool, because that by far will help your water usage and help reduce your water usage. Because we live in a hot, dry climate with windy conditions, that if that pool's not covered, it's gonna evaporate water much like your plants do. Maybe not at the same rate. Do you have a comment about that, Alan? Alan is the gentleman from the pool industry. He may be able to talk about any incentives or issues with pool covers.
Yeah, just really quickly. My name's Alan Smith. I own Alan Smith Pool Plastering out of Orange, and I'm on the California Pool and Spa Association's Board of Directors, and I've been to numerous meetings like this, water district meetings, city council meetings, talk about swimming pool water usage. There's good ways to conserve swimming pool water for those here who have swimming pools. One is with covers. There's a lot of different kinds. There's solid track covers that cover the whole pool. There's bubble cover blankets. There's solar rings that you can throw out and disperse. And then there's a new, fairly new product. It's a liquid you put in there that actually creates a sheen you can't see or feel that reduces water evaporation substantially. We're currently doing testing at the Cal Poly San Luis Obispo comparative evaporation studies on all the different covers. I actually chair that research committee. So we can give good information for pool owners how to slow down evaporation. The average backyard swimming pool evaporates 14,000 gallons a year. That's half as much as what's used for the same amount of pool area as green lawn. So swimming pools use substantially less water than a green lawn does. A covered pool uses substantially less water than drought-tolerant landscaping. So swimming pools are not the issue, properly taken care of. There's also another way to save water is, how many pool owners are here? Do I see? Just, so there's a number of them, the California Dream, all right. Every 3 to 5 years, swimming pools, the water needs to be drained because the total dissolved solid levels get so high and the cyanuric or conditioner level gets so high, the water, you basically can't chlorinate it anymore and becomes a health hazard. That's 20,000, 30,000 gallons that goes down the sewer. That'll screw up your rates, won't it? To refill it, there's now, we just purchased a reverse osmosis machine on a trailer that does 6,000 gallons an hour. I can take the water out of your pool and recycle it, and within a day's time, I can make it into drinking water. It'll cost about as much as the $500 fine, maybe a little bit more. So there's new things we can do to stop that. I haven't got it yet, but there'll be more coming with other companies because that's one way to do this. Or if you're to remodel your pool, you want to replaster it, what are you going to do with that water? We can actually leapfrog water from one pool to another and truck it, so you can still get that if you need to. The cost will be more, but that's part of doing your construction project or draining and refilling your pool. Same with high school pools and commercial pools. Some of those have to be drained yearly, sometimes every 6 months, just to refresh the water to sanitize it. High school pool, that's 350,000 gallons of water. They usually just dump it down the sewer. This way, we can actually get in there and refresh it, make drinking water out of it, and save a lot of water. It's going to cost them more, but everybody's got to pitch in, including the municipalities and the school districts. You're probably not aware of the newer technology. It's just coming on the market for these big RO system, reverse osmosis systems, but they are very effective, and they're coming to help.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Alan. I think the question was, do we help? And I think I answered the question. We don't help, but hopefully you got some ideas. There is technology on the horizon. We strongly suggest, because of the current drought conditions, that unless you really have to drain your pool, that you don't do it this year, or at least not till we figure out what's happening with this water here. So far, not enough water. Okay, rebates for rain barrels and water collection systems not available for us. Why? Edwin, are you here? Yeah. And then advice on gray water usage.
Rain barrels, that's a really good question. I believe there is a rebate, $75 for rain barrels. So pretty much how you do that is you apply online and you purchase that at Lowe's, Home Depot, or wherever you're gonna get that. And they range probably between $75 and $125, and you get $75 back for those.
Do you know which third-party vendor they apply through? Is it OC WaterSmart or no?
They can apply through OC WaterSmart or go on the gswater.com website, and you can get that information there.
Thank you. So the question, actually, rain barrels are an option. We sure could use rain for them. In May, of course, so, I mean, they would have worked, but, okay. And advice on gray water usage. I'm hearing, for those of you that folks that didn't hear it, is rain barrels are not an option in Rossmore Community Service District. Wasn't aware of that. Kind of interesting, because again, there may be some conflicts between state law and local district rules and ordinances. Certainly, the folks in your local community are closer to you and potentially have other enforcement options than the state, but.
On that, right now, contact me and we can work with you because we opened up a new portfolio of rebates. So if MODOC isn't covering that, I know that we can get the money from Metropolitan, so I'll work with you on that.
Was your point that Rossmore doesn't allow them? Okay, that sounds like a problem, a technicality with our website. So this customer was saying that doesn't seem to be an option when you go through gswater.com. When you click Rossmore, you get to nowhere. Is that correct?
And we're not Rossmore and Los Alamos.
We need to check into that because again, those they're in our district, so it could be an issue that Edwin will check up on that. Get your contact information, if you don't mind, to Dell, and we'll make sure we follow up on that question. That doesn't sound right to me, so we'll check on that. Could be a technical issue with our website. It could be that we need to communicate with that third-party vendor that, hey, these are our customers. They are in Orange County, that kind of a thing. So we'll try to get to the bottom of that. We are a homeowner association. Is it possible for our association to use reclaimed water through the city of Cypress? Great question. No, not yet. Why? Because reclaimed and recycled water is delivered through a separate distribution system from a separate source. Currently, your water rates have paid for that very focused regional recycled water system called that GWRS, the groundwater replenishment system. All that water, most of that water is used for that barrier, the ocean intrusion barrier, and for recharge of your underground aquifer. There are some communities in Orange County that developed with recycled water in parallel to their portable water systems, Purple Pipe. And they have typically local recycling systems and a local distribution system supporting that. We don't have that in Orange County, in this part of Orange County. Our neighbors to the west of us have some of those resources in some communities. Dell, what's on the other side of the 605? Is it Long Beach?
Yes, Long Beach.
Long Beach. There's a recycling system, a wastewater recycling system in Long Beach, which is, of course, in LA County. Right?
Yes.
LA County? Yeah, thank you. There is Orange County, Los Angeles County Sanitation District systems that recycle water in various communities. The closest one to the northern part of our district is City of Cerritos, who participates with Los Angeles County Sanitation District. Cerritos has built a distribution system for recycled water. They use recycled water for their medians and for a lot of their parkways and some of their parks in their community. They invested in that system in the 1980s. They've been expanding it as they get grant funds. Typically, it's got to be done reasonably or it's not cost effective. It's actually more expensive to supply that water to the communities than it is to supply portable water if the distribution systems are already in place. That doesn't mean we shouldn't be looking at it. That doesn't mean we shouldn't be looking at those options. And Cerritos recently has gotten grant funds to bring some of that recycled water to Forest Lawn within our district here in Cypress. Forest Lawn's a huge user of water, and that is typically drinking water that they're irrigating their grass with. They have invested and opted to invest in a continuation of that distribution system, and we're working very closely with them and the city of Cerritos to partner in bringing that water to Forest Lawn. Once it's there, maybe there's additional options to expand that system, but again, that means ripping up streets. People don't like ripped up streets. It means investment in the pipelines to go, if there's room, to bring that purple water to other parks and schools. We're looking at those kinds of options and where it makes sense and where we can get funds, then we're trying to do these kinds of improvements on a regional basis. For your specific HOA, Again, it depends on how far away you are and how much money you got. I am part of an HOA, and I know that we don't have the kind of money to invest in a pipeline in the street for several miles to bring purple pipe to our community. But that doesn't mean that it may not happen in the future. I was not at my current property in 2013. So here's a repeat. Previous owner was a single retired person. Why is my family of four based on a single person? It would be based on a, assuming this is your, is this your question? No, okay, we'll give you an option as a follow-up, but yeah, so initially, if we are in stage two or above, the initial allocation point will be based on that water usage in 2013. If that's lower, if that's 8 CCF per month or lower, you don't have anything to worry about. But if you're a family of four and you're irrigating outdoors, you probably will need more water or want more water. That will go into the allocation process or the appeals process again, which will be in place if we have to go to stage two or above. I have an in-ground pool. What guidance can you provide for meeting the reduction target? I think Alan shared there are some technology options out there, but I think by far the simplest is to get yourself the cheapest cover initially as possible, or the best cover you can afford. So whatever you invest will continue to pay you back for years to come. That by far is one of the most efficient things you can do to save water for your pool. Is there a way to tell if there is a leak, such as an underground leak? Great question. Do we have on our website a picture of a meter? No? We don't have a video that shows how a meter will tick and, no? I think we might, but maybe we don't. I'm gonna share, Del, cover your ears. I'm gonna share with you the fact that that meter has a tattletale. That tattletale is usually a small triangle. Sometimes it's a round disc, but it's usually somewhere in the center or maybe between the center point and 12 o'clock on the dial. There's a little dial that if you go ahead and open up your hose bib and have somebody using that water to irrigate, of course, you can see that little dial will spin very, very slow if you just crack that hose bib very minutely. If you open it up, that dial spins even quicker. And every 10 rotations of that little dial will run your sweep hand on your meter from 0 to 1. So 10 rotations, 0 to 1. Well, what is one? Is it 1 CCF or 1/10 of a CCF?
1/10.
1/10. So that little doohickey in the middle, that tattletale, has to run 1,000 times to get you one billing unit. Did I do the math right? 1/10? 100? No, it has to run, I gotta do the math. But 10 rotations of that will get you 1/10 of a cubic foot. So 100 will get you a cubic foot, and 100 times around with the sweep pan will get you 100 CCF, which is 1 billion unit. So yeah, it measures a very, very small amount of water. If you have a leak and it's on your side of the meter, that device is gonna tell you, that little meter, shut off everything in your house that you have control over, listen to those toilets, and if you can't hear them leaking from the back tank into the bowl, and even if you can hear it, that's another way to confirm, yeah, you got a leak. If you have water running subterraneously, it's going to measure through that meter, and you will be responsible for it. Every drop of water that goes to that meter you used, whether you made useful use of that water, it went through that meter. So it is very, very important to fix leaks on a very timely basis. And to find out if there is a leak, and you suspect there might be, you can call our customer service reps. We will send somebody out to help you through that. That's probably the best approach. That's the way Dell would answer that question. He wouldn't suggest that you look at your meter yourself. But there's, don't break the lid. Don't tamper with it. If you're uncertain, absolutely. Call our customer service reps, and he'll send somebody out to help walk you through whether or not we think there's a leak. If it's best if you can be there and you can confirm that there's nobody using water, they'll look at it and they'll see if that thing's moving, there's probably a leak. Do you want to add anything to that, Tom?
Are you sure that you got everything off at your house? You're sure that you don't have what I would refer to as a phantom flush, that flush that nobody's in the bathroom? Be very mindful of your ice makers in your refrigerators, because every so often that will spray water in there to make those ice. You may look at that meter and it may not be spinning at that moment. Stand there for a little bit if you do have an ice maker.
That's a great point. Usually you can hear that hissing, and some folks don't know what that is. The ice maker, if you've got an automated one, they run too. But like he said, they shouldn't run continuously, and if they do, you got water coming into your floor, you got ice being made out of your freezer, the whole freezer. So great point, thanks, Del. All right, question. I only have two more, and then I'll open it up to the whole audience. Property was not occupied for half of 13 for remodeling. How is baseline calculated? Same deal. If we go to stage 2, 3, or 4, appeal. And just share the information. They'll make note of it. They'll look at your average usage. If it was just a glitch, they can look at years back and forward too and say, okay, yeah, something was going on that month. We understand. It makes sense to adjust. What to do if we suspect leaking water meter dial? I think we just covered that. Dial moves very slowly when everything everything is shut off. My next door neighbor's meter was replaced 2 years ago for the same reason. Well, if the water meter is leaking, it has to be leaking on your side to actually register water. If it's leaking on our side, the water didn't go through the meter. We replace meters on a 20-year basis for the typical residential meter, 3/4 inch and 5/8. Every 20 years, depending on how old your meter is, and I'm not saying, the neighbor might have been leaking, or it might also have been, it reached the age where we're replacing them. 1-inch meter is every 15 years. And 1.5 and 2-inch meters every 10 year we'll replace them. But if you suspect a leak might be on the side that it's actually registering water, call our technicians. Somebody, even if it's our call center, they'll get word to Dell and his team, and he'll make sure somebody comes out and helps you through that. Great questions. Okay, we are at the point where I'm going to open it up. Dell has a mic, so I want to make sure everybody can hear your question, and I'll do my best to have our team or somebody answer it. If I don't have the answer, I'll try to get it to you. This gentleman has his hand up over here, Dell. And yeah, no one's hostage here, so please feel free to go whenever.
Mr.
Mills? Gentleman back here, can you raise your hand again unless you don't have a question? Oh, there we go. And sir, we'll come back to you, and I'll remind. So you put your hands down, and I'll ask you again when he's done.
Thank you. I'm not a plumber by any means, but I have a real problem swallowing this flow restrictor charges of $150 to put the flow restrictor on, and then another $150 to take it off. So I don't know where you get off charging $300 to put on and
part
take
of our
off the flow restrictor.
Good question. Part of our part of that issue, again, is if the PUC thinks we're charging too much, they're going to ask the same question. But in general, the guidelines were make these restrictions punitive. I'm being honest. Make the restrictions to the point where they're going to get people's attention. I'm being very honest about it. That was part of the guideline. They may not approve those costs. They may say, prove to us that it's actually your cost, because then you will be required to prove to us. And we're gonna let you put those funds in your operating funds. Right now, any of these fees or fines, we have to track in a separate account, and the PUC still hasn't told us whether or not we'll be allowed to use those revenues to offset those funds to offset revenue losses from selling less water, whether they'll be used in the cost balancing account. Right now, we're gonna have to track those funds separately, and we're not absolutely certain, A, that the PUC will approve them, but we know they gave us guidelines to say, get people's attention. Yes, sorry. Gentlemen, we'll take your question first, but these two folks were next in line. I'm sorry, I saw them. I saw their hands next. This gentleman right here.
Yeah, most of my outdoor watering is for crops. I noticed that you had something about agriculture, that you're not going to make any adjustments for that.
Yeah, the water use restrictions were across the board for all customers. So, again, if we're in stage two or above, or you just can't, if you've already installed and are using water as efficiently as possible with your growing crops, then we're going to have to look at that and determine, A, how do you meet your 16% reduction then? Is it by growing fewer crops? Is it by putting more mulch down? What is it that we can do collectively? What will you do to reduce the 16%? So again, it's across the board, everybody. I'm sorry, yeah, her and then this gentleman, way in the back.
Okay, you've talked about a lot of different things. If I understood you correctly, we're in stage.
Could you hold your mic?
We're in stage one. And we're trying to avoid going to stage two.
You heard me correctly, except I said that the state regs basically put us at a point where I need everyone to start at stage one, and I want to start at stage one. The PUC hasn't adopted any of this yet for us, but the state regs are in place already. Our report cards already have, we have no choice. We still have to report to the state, both the Water Resources Control Board and the PUC, how we did starting June 1. We're actually already doing this reporting every month. They've been tracking it every month. We are recommending that you start, every one of us, and get the word out. Start at stage one, reduce your watering to 2 days a week, use the odd and even addresses. Do it now, because the PUC may adopt it in 10 days. They may adopt it in 20. We're still gonna have to report to the state. And if they think that we didn't do enough, they can up the ante on fines. They can up the ante by saying, you need to go back to the drawing board and make it tougher. So the confusion is, are we in stage one or not? As far as I'm concerned, we are. Legally, the PUC hasn't said yet, but the state of California has.
Okay, my major concern in order to comply with this program is, I have no concept, you know, how fast water is going. I mean, I have very little concept.
Do you receive a water bill?
Yeah. Okay. Yes.
And the reason I ask that is because some folks are apartment complex dwellers.
Are you going to be telling us in our bill where we are in relation to the?
Yes. We are going to, the question is, if you didn't hear it, are you going to be telling us where we are on a regular basis in meeting these goals and objectives? We are putting in place individually on your bill, your 2013 data, and a bar essentially that says where that allocation would be as if we are in stage one and two, the 16% reduction. We are really trying to reduce to the 16 point reduction point. I don't want to go to stage two because that means you're going to pay extra if you don't meet it. I want everybody to implement stage one. Help us get to that reduction so we don't have to go to stage two and start fining you for that additional water use. Is that clear? Okay, and part of her question, and I hadn't heard it yet, was, you know, some folks don't get a water bill. They live in an apartment or a condo complex where it's master metered, and questions are, well, how's the property manager gonna, you know, make sure that my neighbor, I mean, I'll do my part, but how do I know my neighbor's gonna do my part? What's gonna happen there? That's a real tricky situation because that master meter is gonna be handled the same way, according to us. We're gonna look at the usage in 2013 and say it's got to be reduced. If one person does twice as much conservation and the other doesn't do any, then they've met the goal. Is that fair? No. This really isn't, I don't know of a fair way of doing this and implementing something we can manage, we can show that we've communicated and that we can enforce for the majority of the folks. Very, very tricky, though, is how apartment complexes and master metered folks are going to be looking at this. If you read the articles, LA landlords are saying, help us pay for individual meters per building. That's a huge cost. Much better to try to corral the community into saying, the drought is serious, the drought is real, we all need to do their part, our part. Let's not get there with more expenses to anybody. Questions still? Ma'am. Oh, sorry. While the mic is here, and we'll catch you. Yes, sir.
You almost led into my question, and that is the accounting for, and let me say that I met my reduction. My neighbor exceeded his reduction. And on the average, both of us met the reduction. So why should the one of us be penalized? And then to summarize that up at the city level, which you talked about at the city level, if the city meets its reduction and yet there will be individual customers within the city that will exceed their allocation, and then there will be many customers that meet their allocation, why isn't that going to be justly handled? I haven't heard anything or read anything that says that that will be equitably handled. And I agree with you, what you said is what's been set up and what I've heard and read is all penalty.
Right, punitive instead of creative. You know, they're great questions, but how, one size does not fit all. We understand that, but with the tools in place, we have to do something, and we had to implement something very quickly. We're not at a point as a company that we can determine everyone's fair water allocation. How many people do you have in your house? How big is your lot? What's fair and reasonable to use for pools and irrigation? And there's going to be differences of opinion, even in this group, I think, in establishing a system like that. Some communities do have those types of rate structures in place. We do not. And I know it's not a good answer, but that's what we've got. I apologize. Well, and in some case, we actually are, again, but by system level instead of city, because that's how the state's collecting the information, across the system. So it's Stanton and Cypress and Los Alamitos. Well, Stanton folks may do twice as much reduction as Cypress, but those numbers are pooled collectively and sent to the state because the state can't manage 100,000 systems or however many, I mean, city, not 100,000. I don't know how many cities are in California, but the state has to manage the system so far as well. It's doing it by the 411 plus systems that I talked about in the beginning, which are multiple communities in a lot of parts. Resources and people can't get to the point where they can actually figure out and force calculate and determine, okay, Stanton did their part, but Cypress didn't. We have to shift over to Cypress. Could we try that internally? Boy, it'll take a lot of resources as well. But maybe there's something we can do, Golden State Water Company and data crunching, and say, hey, city of Stanton, you folks actually did a little better than your neighbors in Cypress. Cypress, do you want to do a little better? You know, I don't know how to make it work, but we report on a system-by-system basis to the state. Actually, if you have suggestions about how we might be able to do it, we're put it in a comment card if you didn't already. That becomes part of the public record. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we had a round a while back ago where we had to reduce water usage. Nobody seems to mention that. We've always been pretty careful about water. We only have one neighbor. Our neighbor had always used a lot of water, so he had to reduce. He had a lot of cushion there. So we continued reducing our water usage. We no longer have that neighbor. But now we've got ours down pretty low, and when you think about 16%, like maybe that might be hard to achieve, although we're sort of working on it some more. So does that strike you as fair?
No, and as I mentioned, it isn't fair, and typically 16% is going to be a lot easier than 36 and 24. A lot of folks complain to the state. that this whole process isn't fair. We had people testifying to State Water Resources Control Board why it's not fair, and they basically said, we can only do what we can do. Here it is. Sorry. Yes, sir.
I noticed when I take a shower in the morning before 8 o'clock, the pressure is very low. After 9, 10 o'clock, the water pressure is much higher than before. Why?
That's because a lot more people are using water at that time. So a lot more water is going through the mains to supply that water. We're basically a residential community for the most part. So a lot of people might be on traditional work schedules or traditional school schedules. And you're absolutely correct. If we look at both the pressure and the water demands on a diurnal basis throughout the day, pressures go up and pressures go down. And one gentleman had a question or a comment about that. Hey, you know, in Rossmoor, I know we can be anywhere, we can be as high as 95. Well, I'll bet you can be as low as 75 too, depending on the time of day, like this gentleman is saying. And that's a function of pressure and water loss through the pipes. As you push water through the system, there's head loss, friction, and pushing that water through the pipes. And the more water you try to push through the system, the lower the pressure gets in delivering that higher volume. So there is definitely a difference in that pressure throughout the day as well. Now we try to maintain that system by either adding more supply as needed, turning on additional wells, turning on booster stations to maintain a range of system pressures and to maintain the flow demands of the system. Does that answer your question, sir? Great. Question over here, this gentleman, and then we'll get to you, sir. And we're gonna try, I'm sorry. Folks, do you want us to be out of here by a certain period? We're probably winding down, maybe 10, 15 minutes? Okay, yeah, let's wrap this up. Question over there, sir? That one first and then this one. I'm sorry.
Hello, my name's Dave, and I'm on the RCSD board. I have a few questions, actually. On average, and there's no perfect average, what is the percentage of water use indoor versus outdoor?
Good question, and it definitely depends on the size of the lots.
Of course.
Yeah.
Is it 50-50, 80-20?
Let's see. We've looked at data all over the board. In the community that I'm going to say needs to cut 36%, they're using way more than 50% outdoors. Is that no surprise to you? In this community, it's probably a 50-50, roughly on average, which means, again, if you're watering 3 days a week and you cut back one day, what's one-third of 50%? I think it's 16 and a fraction. My math isn't great. Yeah, 16 times 3 is 48. So cutting back that one day of watering will get you to the 16%.
And then you had mentioned that there was a 25% reduction.
Statewide.
Right. And ours is only 16.
Yeah, and that community I'm going to on Thursday is 36. So okay. Averaging it all out, they're trying to get the 25.
Okay, and then at what point will we be able to see on our bill clearly how many PCS we're using to 2013 versus 2015?
Hopefully by your next bill, if you're not within, oh, was that, did someone forget this? Oh, they left it behind? Okay, I don't know if you folks have a lost and found, but Dell, if not, Dell will take it and our customer service reps will make sure that the owner of that gets it back. Thank you, sir. I'm sorry, I was in the middle of a question and lost my train of thought. Where was I?
Just when the bill will be updated.
Oh, when will it? Yeah. Well, two things we're working on right now is actually getting customers 2013 usage to you ahead of your bill. Because, again, some folks are going to be in that cycle where they've already just recently paid a bill. So we're trying to get that out to everybody ahead of time as quick as possible. I've heard within a couple of weeks, and if it doesn't come out to you directly, we will have an online request for your 2013 data. I think they should be able to turn that around within a couple of days. And then we intend to continue to communicate on the bill, every time you get a bill, where that 2013 usage is and where that 16% reduction should be.
So we can safely say by July 1, it'll be public?
Boy, I sure hope so, in one form or other, either on your bill or both. I know today the online request is on our website. Has anyone seen that? Yeah, it's on your website, so you can actually make that request already.
Okay, and then regarding water pressure, we know that we have four 13-hour periods where we can water outdoors. So yeah, the other 160 hours or whatever in during the week, can the water company actually reduce their water pressure? Because I know consistently for about 3 years my water was 80 to 85 max, regardless in a 24 any time during the day. Now it's over 95.
So the question is, can we reduce our water pressure in those periods where you're not using water for irrigating?
It's gone up about 15 pounds on average just a couple weeks.
Interesting question. In the last couple of weeks?
Yes.
Well, that's...
I've had a gauge on my hose bid for about 4 years.
We'll look into what's going on, because it could be testing of systems, it could be maintenance on a well or a pump station. But we'll definitely look into that.
And then to assist the water company and residents, my plan with the Rossmore Community Services District is actually try to hold some very informal town hall meetings through the Rossmore Community Service District, where anybody in Stanton, LaSalle, you know, we're not geographically discriminating. We can sit around a table and say, okay, I got four people in my house. Here's my bill. We get up on a whiteboard and says, well, here's your 2013. You know, do you have a lot of plants? Do you have to take a lot of showers? And because I'm not a great public speaker myself. It's a little intimidating.
You're doing a fine job.
It's intimidating to get on a mic, and I'm sure, you know, 80% of the people in this room are a little hesitant. But I really want to get an informal thing where we get 25, 50 people. I don't think you could have 150 people.
Were you at the meeting in Rossmore a couple weeks ago?
Yes, I was.
My understanding is you had over 80, is that correct?
Well, there was about 50 people there. But again, there were about five people that asked questions. And the water company did try to address those, but I think we need to get it down to the individual, you know, less intimidating environment to actually allow people to ask questions and not feel stupid like I do sometimes asking questions.
Is this less intimidating to you? I didn't mean to be way up front.
Well, slightly, actually.
Okay.
But anyway, and then, so your contention is that water pressure has no impact on water usage? Because I don't believe that's the case.
I'm not sure I said that. Did I say that?
Okay.
Yeah.
Because if we reduced our water pressure on average to 75 pounds.
I actually gave you ways that you might handle that yourself. Because again, if we adjust one person's water pressure, there's absolutely a possibility that somebody else in the same system may be too low and saying, why did my system go down by 15 or 20 PSI? But what you're saying sounds like an anomaly or a different source of supply or some other component of our system, which is great. It's a reliable system, but maybe a pump station or a well closer to your home has been cycled on, whereas one further away was operating weeks ago, that kind of a thing.
Yeah, that's fine. And as part of my goal, too, is to obtain XD or hundreds of meters or valves that we can provide at no cost, because I don't think I'm an anomaly. And as far as putting a regulator on, yeah, I think people are putting them on because it's anything above 80 PSI is not good for your plumbing, even though most people have problems with that. But I think as we implement these restrictions on watering, and at 7 in the morning, it jumps up. And there's lots of variables of water usage, but
right, and that's part of the the plumbing code today too. Is new homes have to be installed with a pressure regulator if the static pressure is above 80 psi to the lot.
Yeah, and one of my goals too is to work with a local plumber, because right now the regulator is probably $400 installed, pretty pricey.
Yeah, it is.
Anyway,
thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. This gentleman next, sorry. And just time for two more questions.
Thank you.
I can take some questions outside if you'd like.
This isn't a question. I just wanted to pass something on, some information to people. In 1987, we had a drought.
And at that time, my wife and I bought two-gallon buckets because it takes from our two-story home in the master bedroom upstairs and the water heater down in the garage, it takes 2 gallons of water to get hot water upstairs. So we've been putting it in that bucket every morning.
Do you use it for the first flush of the day?
I'm sorry?
Do you use it for the first flush of the day?
No, I use it outside.
Oh, because also you can actually flush your toilet with that bucket of water. You don't have to bring it all the way outside. I know that sounds kind of creepy, but the fresh water doesn't have to come from the back of the tank. You can also just take that bucket of water and use it to flush your toilet if it needs to be flushed.
Well, we've been doing that every morning and night, and it's a ritual. I take it downstairs, and the next day we
have...
That's
why it looks so healthy, too.
We have 4 gallons of water every day that we put in the yard, and when it rains, I have trash cans that I put it in there until the rain's over with, and then I use it.
So did you hear that, too? He's got a cheaper solution to that rain barrel event.
Yep.
Put a trash can out with a hefty
those plastic trash
liner.
Cans. Yep. The big plastic trash.
Great ideas. Thank you for sharing.
And the other day, I had a 2 gallon deal. My car was dirty. I used a rag, washed off my car, dried it off, and it threw the dirty water on the ground. So it's a good way. Every time water goes down that drain, we cannot retrieve it.
Actually, all water on the planet's recycled one way or other, but good points. Yes, sir.
How soon after you submit your request for your 2013 water usage will you get it?
I know they are working on that. It should be a couple days,
okay.
But we're also working on a collective outreach, and I believe it's going to be by direct mail. That'll give you, the notice that does say officially the CPUC adopted this Schedule 14, and B, here's your 2013 water usage. So if you can't wait, go ahead and go online and request that information. I think you should get it in a few days. Last question, sorry. I have time to take more questions outside if you'd like.
The 16% reduction, is that going to be every month or be like a rolling average over a couple or three
Great
months?
Question. Why can't we carry over minutes or gallon CCF like Verizon or whoever might do on your water bill? The point is, unfortunately, the state's looking at this both on a month-by-month basis and determining whether or not we're doing enough, and then at the end of the year, they're also looking at it collectively if we have to go another year, another round. But we report every month, and we strongly recommend you do everything you can and start now, even though, again, you get a bill every 2 months, but I'm trying to give you all the tips and pointers to say, do everything you can to conserve and to use the water as wisely as you can. Thank you, folks. I want to make sure these, please give me a hand giving the Cottonwood Church and their folks a hand. Thank you for staying with us and for allowing us.